Savvy Central Radio, drawing out the best from our guests, with host Christina Nitschmann.
You were in love once upon a time. Choose peace, not war, for a happier ever after. A Healthy Divorce Workbook by Cindy Battino with Lauren R. Giannini. Enter a new kind of self-help book for mind, body, and divorce. Cindy discusses finance, children, attorney, sex, you name it. The goal is to help people go through an often damaging and painful process by taking on as little damage and baggage as possible. To get your copy today, go to transform-heal.com/divorce-workbook. Our guest today is Christine L. Conroy, author of Stitch Your Own Silver Linings, a breakthrough guide to helping yourself to happiness no matter what. For over 25 years, Christina L. Conroy owned a successful designer business until cancer struck three members of her family. The personal journey that followed dramatically changed her perspective on life. Today, Christina shares her journey and discusses her journey towards happiness and a purpose-filled life. To find out more about Christine, visit her website at ChristineLConroy.com. Hi, Christine. Welcome to Savvy Central Radio. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. And thank you much for inviting me, Christina. I'm really excited to be talking to you.
I'm excited, too. We've been connecting via Facebook for quite some time and going back and forth. And I saw your book when you had launched it a while back. And I was like, wow, that sounds so cool. I can't wait to read it. And I eventually did get to read it. Thank you so much for sending me a wonderful, beautiful copy that you also inscribed. The book is really awesome because it brings back what a lot of my listenership has gone through and also guess, which is that many times in our life we'll go through a crisis that turned our life upside down, inside out, and transforms us. And that happened to you, and also what eventually led to the creation of your book, Stitch Your Own Silver Lining, a breakthrough guide to helping yourself to happiness no matter what. How did this all come about for you?
Well, I'll try to be brief. It's an interesting story, but I'll jump into the story if I can with me at the age of 34, if that's okay, Christina.
Oh, you betcha.
Yeah, because by that time I was married with three gorgeous children, two boys and a girl, and my husband and I worked together. We ran a very successful furniture manufacturing company, and at that time we employed over 60 people. You know, we were both very driven and goal-oriented, and we worked really hard, but the rewards were good. We had a lovely big home, we drove nice cars and took fabulous holidays, even had nannies to help with the children. Really, I suppose we were well on our way to achieving all the things that our society values and sees as success. But by the time I was 37, the Conroy women, I call them, that is my mother, my sister, and my seven-year-old daughter, had all been diagnosed with cancer.
Mm.
They had different cancers that were totally unrelated. My mum suffered from lung cancer. My sister had Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is cancer of the lymphatic system. And my daughter had an osteosarcoma, or a bone cancer, in her left arm. And it was my daughter's case that was that really was the most perplexing, I think, for the medical profession. And in the end, they amputated her arm in order to save her life, but even then gave her only 12 months to live. 12 months later, we were blessed to still have Charlotte. We still had our daughter, but by that time we'd lost everything else. I mean, we were living in abject fear, as you can imagine, and it took its toll. We lost the business, we lost the cars, the holidays, and everything that went with it, the nannies included, but thankfully not our home. But we did hit rock bottom, and it took for that to happen before we realized that we needed to change our attitudes. The Conroy women were dealing with the situation with such bravery, really, and grace that we felt that if they could do that, then surely we ought to be able to do that too. And they became our teachers. Between us, we came up with all kinds of ways to try to deal with this horrendous situation and to try to inject some normality back into our lives. You know, we had three small children to take care of, so we needed to get our lives back. And my mother and sister encouraged me to start writing things down, which I did. And eventually they became, if you will, Stitch Your Own Silver Linings.
Mm.
The story behind the book.
Wow.
Stories of the Conroy women, because I want people to meet them. They're, you know, they're strong and funny and inspirational. And I use their stories to demonstrate the effectiveness of what we called the Conroy concept of happiness and well-being.
Mm. And it goes to show you, Christine, I think many of us through crisis and trial actually are brought to our actual most strength and greatness. And we wouldn't even dream it possible what we can accomplish and do until sometimes tragedy happens in our life. It's sad, though. I wonder why often in my life sometimes, because I had a turn of bad health before I started to really think about changing my life and transforming it and building my business. Why often does it take disaster for people to reexamine their life and make the necessary changes to find their own silver lining and happiness in their life?
Oof, that's a tough question, Christina. But it is actually one that I've asked myself, because my work involves encouraging people to skip the disaster part, if you like, and, you know, not wait to be knocked sideways by a crisis before making those necessary changes. However, Marianne Williamson said something that really resonated with me. She says, "Something very beautiful happens to people when their world has fallen apart. A humility, nobility, and a higher intelligence emerges at just the point when our knees hit the floor." And I love that. I absolutely love that. And I can vouch for it 100%. But I also believe that we can create a true happiness in our lives right now and use that to help us to build the resilience we need to put our lives back together when they fall apart, and to be conscious of the gift or the silver lining contained within the experience. And I know it sounds a little bit of a cliche, it's nonetheless true that it was going through the experiences with the Conroy women that I found my purpose and that kind of true, longer lasting happiness, if you will.
Yeah. And I'm wondering right now, listening to you, because I know for myself, and I'm not any different than anyone else, that small stuff will come up in our lives and we'll blow it out of proportion. We'll get all upset about small things in our life and make ourselves unhappy. And so that brings me to asking you, what exactly is happiness? How do you define it? And how do you define being happy?
Right. Well, I mentioned the Conroy concept of happiness and well-being, which is introduced in the book. And that's a process that kind of brings together everything I've learned in my life from my spiritual and personal development studies, but mostly the incredible lessons learned from the Conroy women. And it looks at seven key areas of life that I believe need to be nurtured in order to bring us a longer lasting happiness. And I think thanks to new sciences such as positive psychology and neuroscience, we now know more than ever about what makes us happy and what doesn't. And I think we have to start listening to that. Positive psychology, which underpins most of what I do, gives a very simple but concrete definition of happiness. And that is, happiness is living a flourishing and fulfilling life, experiencing positive emotions most of the time. So not all of the time. You know, I often say that true happiness is not about being cheerful and upbeat all of the time. You know, that's completely unnatural. I mean, negative emotions are important to us, but it's when they start to take over that it becomes a problem. And that's what happened to us before we hit rock bottom through our experiences with the Conroy women.
Mm, I can imagine anyone going through that experience. It's almost impossible not to have gotten some negative experiences and stay there. And I think that's the key, is that whatever is going on in your life is not to stay stuck in those negative emotions, whether it be, and here's a big one, Christine, which I'm sure you hear about a lot when you lecture and work with people, which is stress. And stress is such a negative component that I think affects health and happiness in a big way.
Yeah, it does. But it's about when something happens that's so negative, such as, for example, that happened with us and the Conroy women, you tend to slip into what I call absolute negative thinking. And I think this is what causes a lot of the stress. This when I say absolute negative thinking, what I mean by that is, so for example, when we were found ourselves in a situation, you know, the three most important women in my life had cancer, mm-hmm. I slipped immediately into this way of thinking, which goes, oh my goodness, they're all going to die. I'm not going to cope. I'm going to die. The world is doomed. You know, and that's the kind of absolute negative thinking I'm talking yeah. about. When in fact, if you can just shift your thinking a little bit, not a lot, you know, because it's unrealistic to think that if someone said to me in that situation, oh, you must think positive, very difficult thing to do. Mm. So what you do is what I call the catch and question method of thinking. So when you catch yourself thinking in that absolute negative way, that's what you've got to do. First of all, catch yourself doing it and then use the facts to question that. So, for example, they're all going to die. Well, these days, Christina, a cancer diagnosis is not a death sentence by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, we're curing cancers now that were killers 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, so listening to that, I think, well, okay, well, maybe they're not all going to die. So all of a sudden, a little injection of hope there, positive emotion comes in, and that allows you to, as I say, to think, well, maybe there's something we can work with here. Maybe we can use that hope to kind of work our way through this situation and actually do something about it. And, you know, once you start thinking positively, it does tend to beget positivity. So it tends to grow, and that helps you to be able to move constructively through the experience you're in.
Wow. And indeed, I remember back when I was a teenager, 8 people within my family got diagnosed with cancer in 1 year. Now, mind you, most of them were not really close to me other than my grandma and my uncle. Yeah. But the idea that so many people that I knew getting cancer scared me, yeah. and it became my number one fear. Every time I got a pain somewhere in my body, it was like, oh no, I'm dying. And that's it, I have cancer. it became a little bit of an obsession. But what I found very interesting is during my grandma, who was my best friend and who lived with us as like a second mom, when she got cancer, I started going to a support group for terminally ill patients and their families. And it was so positive. I met a lot of people within the group that were using alternative therapies, and that through getting cancer and terminal illness, they actually transformed their lives, both mind, body, and spirit, in that now they were living more fuller, grander lives. And in essence, sometimes even healthier than before they got cancer, because now they're paying attention to how they live their life, what they put in their body, and all of that.
Yeah, which is fantastic, isn't it? Where there's so much information available to us these days, and resources, like you say, that you, if you're in that situation, you need not be alone. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the message I think we need to get across. You do not need to face these things alone. There are support groups out there that are there just to help you. And I think that's an important thing to stress. But I think cancer has had such a, you know, the word cancer, as I say, at one point meant a definite death sentence. And it doesn't mean that anymore.
Yeah. Absolutely. And from your experience, through all that you've journeyed through with the going through this and writing the book, what has come out as your greatest lesson learned so far?
Oh, I think there are so many, so many. But I think the key thing is that certainly it's all about choice, that happiness itself is a choice that we can make, and that it's not what happens to you, but how you choose to think about what happens to you that makes the difference.
Mm.
Sense.
Yeah. And you had said in the book, and I'm sure outside the book, that your sister and your mom and your daughter have been great role model for you. Has there been anyone else that's really inspired you on this journey as well?
Oh, lots and lots of people. Too many to mention, I think. But the Conroy women do have to come at the very top of the list. My daughter in particular. Can I tell you just one story to demonstrate why?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Well, when it was discovered, Charlotte, that's my daughter, when it was discovered that her condition might be serious, things started to move pretty fast. And we were sent for further investigation to a hospital that's about 2.5-hour drive from where we lived. I mean, that 2.5-hour drive was the longest two hour and a half of my life. You know, we were absolutely sick with fear the whole journey, because we didn't know what was going to meet us when we got there. And we finally arrived, and my husband stayed at the reception area taking care of paperwork and so on, and Charlotte and I went up to the ward where she was going to be staying for the week. And I was trying to be playful and silly with Charlotte, you know, she was only seven. I was trying to kind of lighten the mood. And then we walked through the doors and onto the ward, and I stopped dead in my tracks. The beds lining each side of the ward were filled with children of all ages, some of them hooked up to IV drips, some of them missing limbs, most of them without hair, and all of them with that kind of unmistakable pallor that says seriously ill. I've never seen anything like it, and it felt like we'd walked into a war zone. I immediately felt dizzy and faint, and I was shaking and totally rooted to the spot. Now, I just couldn't move. And all of a sudden, I felt this little warm hand slip into mine, and shaking my hand for attention, Charlotte looked up at me and she said, "Never mind, Mummy. We'll probably get used to it tomorrow." Oh,
wow.
You know, I feel emotional now when I talk about it now. So powerful, you know. Here was my seven-year-old daughter, who must have been so confused and frightened herself, comforting me. No, I thought my heart was going to burst and my knees hit the floor right there and then in the middle of the ward. And somehow a determination took hold of me. I just took her in my arms and said, "Yes, we are going to get used to it. And what's more, we're going to do whatever it takes to get you better." Mm. You know, and that's just one example of how we were guided by the Conroy women as to how to deal with what was happening. I mean, all three of the Conroy women, amazing courage and truly inspirational. And as I say, that's just one story of how they taught us and inspired us to deal with the situation.
Yeah, and there's many more that everyone out here listening in could go find out themselves when they go buy your book, Stitch Your Own Silver Lining Today. But your book also offers, along with the inspirational stories, they also offer readers many resources to help them on their road towards happiness or whatever trials and tribulations they might be going through. And my favorite exercises in your book were the ones around forgiveness and gratitude. Why is... I know, I love it because it's so important. I think we forget about that simple act of gratitude and forgiveness. Why is it so important, these two elements in creating a happy life?
Okay, well, let me take forgiveness first, because this is, you know, there is no doubt that bitterness and resentment are killers without question. Don't know who said it, but unforgiveness is like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. Okay. Some people, you know, carry this resentment around for years, and it simmers under the surface and causes untold invisible damage until one day, bam, heart attack, over. You know, it's not only essential to forgive for your happiness, but it's vital to your well-being. Having said that, Christina, I also know it happens to be one of the most difficult things to do, and that's why I included exercises in the book. Now, and if anyone out there is struggling with this issue, and I know lots of people do, I've put together a forgiveness report for your listeners. Shall I tell you about that now?
Oh, thank you. Yes, most definitely.
Yeah, it can be downloaded at christinelconroy.com/gift. So that's christinelconroy.com/gift. And I've included the forgiveness exercise in that. So that's a free downloadable report. You know, because I know when someone hurts you deeply, Christina, you don't even want to forgive them for a short while, do you?
Mm-mm,
you know, you're angry and upset and disappointed and all of those things. And I think you're entitled to be those things, but only for a short while. because as I say, if you carry that kind of negative emotion around with you, then it's going to make you ill. And, you know, for your own sake, not necessarily for the person who's upset you, you have to work on trying to erase those negative emotions. You know, and that's why I included the exercise in the book.
Mm. Yeah.
I think gratitude and appreciation is a little bit easier for us to do. I think we just need to remember. I mean, you know, lots of us feel appreciative, don't we? But we just have to remember to show it and consciously, or be aware of the fact that we feel grateful. You know, I know during any given day, negative things happen. Of course they do. But if for the most part you give more attention or more energy to the positive things that happen and be grateful for them, pretty soon positivity starts to grow and you find yourself feeling positive emotions most of the time, which takes us back to our definition of happiness.
Yeah, absolutely. And I love what you mentioned about forgiveness, because early on in my childhood, my father was abusive, and in my 20s, my parents had already separated when I was a teenager. And at one moment, my dad said to me, when he would call me on the weekends, "Why don't you want to talk to me? You always seem to get me off the phone so quickly." And I always kept this resentment and anger and actually a little bit of hate in the back of my mind and in my spirit, that's why I was really curt with him. And I couldn't answer him. I was so angry. He was like, "How do you not know why I'm angry?"
Yeah. Absolutely.
So I hung up and I was really angry, and I realized I was hurting myself and the relationships around me, especially if I met any men, I was really mean to them.
Right.
And I remember telling my friend, "I have to get rid of this because it's poison to me. My dad doesn't know what's going on. He doesn't feel this, but I'm hurting myself." So I went through a process of a couple of years of journaling and whatever. And what really helped was we had a chat where in a very calm manner one day I was able to tell him why I was really angry.
Right.
And he was upset about it because you don't like hearing stuff that is not positive about you. But it was the beginning of us being able to forgive each other and open up the space of forgiveness for both of each other, you know, for both of us.
Yeah.
So it's such a wonderful tool. And it was so like a big brick was lifted off of both of us.
Right.
Yeah. Great exercises.
But I have to recognize here, Christina, what you did there was a very brave thing to do. You must have found it difficult to do. It is, as you just, it's difficult to approach someone and tell them negative things about themselves. Or, you know, it's not an easy thing to do. And it was also very telling that you said your father didn't even know about the problem, and yet you'd been suffering from it all of that time. You know, it makes sense to do what you did. And it can sometimes be a long process, forgiveness.
Yeah.
But I think it is definitely worth the effort.
Yeah, it certainly is. And what was interesting is that whenever we go through anything in our life, none of us have perfect lives. We've hurt people along the way, no matter what we've done. And so I think in each of our own perspectives, we'll see our life and our behaviors in a different manner than maybe the people who we hurt, who will see a totally or have a totally different perspective of what happened and what went on.
Yeah.
So when I talked to my dad, he was shocked because some of the experiences from his perspective were different and he didn't experience them the same way.
Right.
So it allowed him to realize, wow, I had no idea how hurtful my actions were to you and how I hurt you. And it was just wonderful. And what really helped me was a book called The Little Soul, written by Neil Donald Walsh. And it was a cool story about this soul who talks to God and says, "I want to go to Earth and I want to be light. I want to be light in the darkness. I want to be light." and God's like, "Are you sure you want this?" So the whole book's kind of like that. And so finally he's like, yes, I want to be light. So at one point, before God's about to send the soul to Earth, he said, "Okay, but please remember that for you to be light, I will send darkness into your realm or your space."
Yeah.
"And remember that in order for you to be light, I must give you the gift of darkness so that you can shine into the darkness." So I gave that book to my dad as a gift, and it was kind of a remembrance to both of us that we are sometimes darkness in other people's lives, but it allows them the gift to forgive us and for us to all grow.
Yeah. And the two of you, your relationship has now grown, presumably, exponentially since then.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, now he has died, but I'm sure.
Oh, right. Okay. Sorry to hear that.
But yeah, it did grow, and it was an awesome experience. And then, like, gratitude, which you said, which is so important as well, because there are times, like, even something's going wrong. A number of years ago, I lost my job, and you think the whole world's falling apart.
Yeah.
But, like, one person said to me, "Look in your pantry right now. You have about 6 months' worth of food that you haven't even touched," because especially in the United States, we have a habit to go and buy a lot of things and then not even realize our pantry's already full. We're just not using it.
Right. Yeah, well, there you go. I mean, and being conscious of being grateful for those things, I think is key, you know.
Absolutely. What is your grand vision? What's coming up for you, your work, your business in this coming year?
Well, I've been asked by quite a few of my readers if there are any related courses they can take. And so I'm looking into that. I'm actually working on that as we speak. And in the meantime, I want to spread the ideas in the book to as wide an audience as possible, you know, so through speaking engagements and workshops, etc., radio shows such as this one, Christina, thank you very much again. Just to hopefully to reach some people out there who may be on the journey further back than I am. You know, so that if there's anybody out there I can turn around and help them along the way, then that's what I'm setting out to do.
Absolutely. That is fabulous. How can anyone find out more about you, get your book?
Well, Stitch Your Own Silver Linings is available. It's available in paperback and on Kindle, and it's available from Amazon and Barnes & Noble, all the usual places. And for those of you who buy the book, there's a free downloadable workbook that goes with it because, you know, I don't want the book to simply be a good read. I think creating happiness is about taking action, and I wanted the workbook to go along with it to help people to be able to do that. I'd also like your listeners to contact me. I mean, I really like to hear comments and questions about anything relating to the book or just people's own stories about, you know, about their help, how they help themselves. And to that end, I've put the my email addresses in the book to allow people to do that. So I'd love to hear from your listeners once they've read the book.
Oh, that's fabulous. Well, thank you, Christine. I thank you so much for sharing your wisdom and your book. Thank you so much for coming to Savvy Central Radio. But before we head on out, is there any parting word you'd like to leave with our audience?
No matter what is happening in your life, you have more control of your happiness than you think you do. You can choose it and you can create it.
Perfect ending to our time together.
Thank you very much, Christina. It's been lovely.
Thank you, Christine. I'm so grateful you came out today to Savvy Central Radio. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Carlene Pettit, author of Flight to Success, Be the Captain of Your Life. Inspiration, motivation, and lessons learned, Flight to Success is the author's journey through 8 airlines, 7 type ratings, 2 master degrees, and motherhood. Flight to Success, intertwined with her stories, are those of others who share their successes, failures, loss, fears, hopes, and dreams. The secrets correlate with many aspects of flight. If you apply the tips in Flight to Success to your daily life, there is nothing you cannot accomplish. To find out more and get your copy today, visit Carlene Pettit, PETITT.com. There are some exciting changes coming this 2015 for Savvy. We'll start videocasting some of our interviews. Also, stay tuned for a new book presently being worked on by my co-author and I, Karen Rowe. We'll talk about how to bridge the gap from worker bee to business owner and the lessons we've learned on our journey to entrepreneurship. In addition, this spring we'll start live interview opportunities in Manhattan, which will later be aired on iHeartRadio, a new mix to business networking and interviews. For those interested in participating as a paid sponsor or interviewee, contact us at 718-713-2289 or savvycentralradio@gmail.com.